chromium, two of the CO2, and you add up water.
Two of these?
No, you have two on the right side.
On the right side,
yeah.
Two of these and
two of these, two of those, and a water.
Two of these, two of these, and a water?
Yeah.
Okay. Is that it?
Well, that's what I got.
Okay, well, the problem here is the atoms balance, let's see, two chromiums, seven oxygens plus four is 11 oxygens. And so we got two times two is four plus one. And so we got to check atom balance. And then right off, you see the charges? The charges don't balance. This is minus two and zero. This is plus six. So it's not quite balanced. Did you get it?
I think so.
Okay. What did you get?
I got one dichromate.
Okay.
Plus eight H plus. Plus three oxalic acid. Yields two Cr3 plus. Plus seven H2O. Plus six CO2 gas.
Okay, so first thing I would probably look at is the charge. You know, minus two plus eight is plus six, plus two times three is plus six. So the charge is balanced. And I check the atom balance. Two chromium, seven, plus 12 is 19 oxygens, seven, plus 12 is 19 oxygens, eight hydrogens, plus six is 14 hydrogens, and then six carbons, six carbons. So the atoms are balanced and the charge is balanced. So this looks good. The atoms balanced, charge balanced, and it's good. How did you do it?
Skeleton redox.
Skeleton redox. Yeah, so you broke it up into two half reactions, right? You did dichromate goes to chromium 3. Dichromate goes to chromium 3 is on our chart, right? So you could just copy it down. Dichromate plus 7H pluses plus 6 electrons, right? And then you did oxalic acid goes to
CO2,
and then balance that one. That one actually turns out to be not so difficult to balance, I think. Goes to CO2. So this is going to go to two CO2s plus two H pluses plus two electrons, right? And that's. And then we add those two together, this is what you get. All right, what's the driving force for this? So let's analyze the driving force for this next. The driving force is, this is going to be our oxidizing agent. This is our reducing agent. Going backwards, what's our oxidizing agent? What's our reducing agent? Cr3 plus is reducing agent. Cr3 plus in the water. This is a reducing agent. And CO2 would be our oxidizing agent. Now, what do you think is a more powerful oxidizing agent? CO2 or dichromate and acid? Yeah, dichromate and acid. This one, you just, from experience, CO2, we know from experience, isn't very good. And dichromate is, dichromate's this orange solid over there. That orange solid, if you spill some on the counter, wipe it up with a wet towel, you know? If you spill some on the counter, don't sneeze. If you sneeze, you're gonna blow it up into the air like fine flour, and you might inhale it, and it's going to burn as it oxidizes your mucous membranes. And so, not only that, chromium 6, what do you know about chromium 6? Chromium 6 is a health hazard. Potential what? Carcinogen. And so, Be careful. Don't, you know, make a mess there. Be aware of other people as well. You don't want to get them. Harmed from the hexavalent chromium. Okay, so this is step one. Step one is a redox reaction. We're going to reduce the chromium 6 to chromium 3. Step two is going to be a acid-base reaction, and this is why we're adding excess potassium oxalate. This is going to be a Lewis acid-base reaction. A Lewis acid base reaction is the chromium 3. Now that we formed the chromium 3 ion, we're going to attack it with the ligand. What's the ligand that we want? Oxalate. And how many oxalates do we want?
Three.
And so we need excess potassium oxalate. The excess potassium oxalate is going to supply plenty of oxalate. So for example, we don't want to form monooxalato or dioxalato. We want to form trioxalato. That is completely reacted with oxalate. And so this is just going to go to trioxalato chromate 3 ion. Trioxalato chromate 3, do you know what the coordination number of this is?
Six.
And so it's going to be an octahedral arrangement. And each oxalato is bidentate. So that, like that. You just do it shorthand like this. And so we'll have three oxalatos. Yeah. Now what I want to do is I want to precipitate this out. It's a 3- ion. 3- is a high charge. And so high charged ions are usually pretty insoluble, but the problem with this one is it's so big. It's 3- charge is kind of spread out. And it's not concentrated. But I'm going to look for a cation. You know, what kind of cation should I look for to precipitate this out? So this is metathesis. You know, metathesis thinking, we want a cation that would precipitate that out. Give me a cation, or guess a cation that might be effective at precipitating out this big, bulky anion. Yeah, maybe calcium, you know, calcium, strontium, barium, because calcium is a 2+. But probably better than
aluminum?
Calcium would be magnesium. Magnesium is even smaller. So magnesium has, you know, it's less soluble. Aluminum it would be really good. Why?
Because it's plus 3.
Yeah, plus 3. Or, what other plus 3 ions do you know? Lead would be plus 2, but it could be pretty effective. Lead is a 2-4, but the plus 4 lead is not stable as an ion. The bonding is quite covalent.
Iron
3 is good. And so I might try iron 3. You know, iron 3, try to precipitate this stuff out. How about potassium ions? Do you think potassium ions would work very well or very effectively? Why not? They're only plus 1, and potassium ions are big. You know, iron 3 ions are tiny, potassium ions are huge. And so potassium ions aren't going to be very effective at precipitating this stuff out. And so if I have potassium ions in here, you know, this solution would be pretty close to ideal. What do I mean by ideal? You know, if I have potassium ions in this solution here, it'll be pretty ideal in the sense that what? Did I talk about this yesterday? Maybe I didn't. Did I talk about ideal solutions versus real solution? No? Okay. Well, let me talk a little bit about this.
All right.
chapter 14 deals with solutions, and the first part of chapter 14 just talks about solutions, homogeneous mixtures, solutes, solvents, that kind of stuff. And then it goes on. Near the end of this, we get into colligative properties. Colligative properties are a collection of properties that depend on kind of the same thing. It depends on how many solute particles are dissolved in solution. And so it depends on how many solute particles. You know. So for example, if I have sodium chloride, each formula unit of sodium chloride makes two solute particles, a sodium ion and a chloride ion. And so that's two. Whereas if I had something like magnesium chloride, that would make three. And so we have equations for these things, all colligative properties. The colligative properties would be the molality of the total solute. So something like magnesium chloride breaks up into three ions, magnesium and two chlorides. So for every magnesium chloride, I have three solute. That's this I here. That's the Van't Hoff factor, I. And so one molal of magnesium chloride produces three molals of solute particles. So we have to multiply the molality of the magnesium chloride by three to get the total number of solute particles. You see that? This is what we call ideal, though. This is ideal behavior. Ideal behavior is magnesium chloride is a soluble salt. Soluble salts are strong electrolytes. Strong electrolytes completely ionize or completely dissociate in solution, right? But that's ideal behavior. And sometimes things don't behave ideally, like gases. You know, gases at room temperature and atmospheric pressure are pretty ideal. But at cold temperatures, gases start to deviate from ideal behavior. At high pressures, gases start to deviate from ideal behavior as well. And the same thing with solutions. The solutions will deviate from ideal behavior. So let's take a look at this chart here. Ideally, sodium chloride should split up into how many solute particles? Two. And so ideally, sodium chloride should split up into two. Well, that's what we see when the solutions are very, very dilute. When the solutions are very, very dilute, it behaves ideally. But as the concentration of the solution increases, it starts to deviate from ideal behavior. So for example, at sodium chloride at concentrations of 1.0 molal, the particles effectively split up into 1.81. Well, how can you take one sodium and get 1.81 particles from that? Well, how you can get that is, what this means is that about 10% of the particles are what we call paired up, ions paired or clustered. And so what's happening here is this. If a sodium is moving this way and the chloride is moving this way, we assume ideally they don't see each other. They just keep moving on their own independent path. But in reality, a sodium is positively charged, the chloride's negatively charged, and when they cross paths like this, they're going to be attracted, right, due to the electrical attraction, but not strong enough to bind and precipitate, but strong enough that for a moment they act as a pair. And so this is an ion pairing. And so basically, what we're going to have is we're going to have about 10% ion pairs. And those 10% ion pairs, you know, they're going to break apart, but new ones are going to form. There's going to be a dynamic equilibrium between these pairs. And the way it's going to look is something like this. You know, the sodiums are going to like to pair up with the chloride. When they pair like this, it's not strong enough to precipitate, but it's strong enough to to cause these deviations from ideal behavior. And the higher the concentrations, the more likely these pairing interactions are going to occur. And so higher concentrations cause a deviation from ideal behavior, but there's one other thing that causes a deviation from ideal behavior. What's that?
Well, let's take a look at the data here.
Like sodium chloride, magnesium sulfate should break up into two ions. So ideally, magnesium sulfate breaks up into magnesium ion and sulfate ion, two ions. But at concentrations of about one molal, take a look, about 50% of them are paired. Do you see that? And so rather than behaving as two independent particles, it behaves as kind of one unit, these two particles. This pairing happens, you know, because of the electrical attractions. Which one's going to have stronger electrical attractions? Magnesium, which is 2 plus, and a sulfate, which is 2 minus, or sodium, which is plus 1, and a chloride, which is minus 1? The magnesium sulfate. So we expect magnesium sulfate to deviate more significantly from ideal behavior because of its higher charge. So what would behave more ideally, iron 2 or iron 3? Iron 2 should behave more ideally. Iron 3 should deviate further from ideal behavior because of its higher charge, and the more likely it's going to pair up with things like anions, like nitrate. In fact, iron three, if you have iron three nitrate, it's hard to break off all the nitrates. You know, sometimes one nitrate tags along, like one of those pilot fish on a whale, something like that. You know, the nitrate's just tagging along on the iron three, something like that. Except it's much bigger. So, what's important about this? What's important about this is this. These here. So, if we really want to do accurate calculations, probably shouldn't use the ideal concentration in our calculations. We probably should use the effective concentrations. Otherwise, we could have up to, 10% or even a 50% error, depending on how much it deviates from ideal behavior. And do you know what these effective concentrations are called? Effective concentrations are called the activities. Well, isn't that what we're supposed to be using in the K? The K is supposed to be the activity of the product over the activity of the reactants. But have we been using these effective concentrations, or have we been using the ideal concentration? We've been using the ideal concentrations. In reality, we should be using the effective concentrations because it depends on, how much is deviating from ideal behavior, but it could cause a pretty significant error in our calculation. And so are we going to be using effective concentrations or real activities? No, we're just going to say the activity of a pure solid is about 1. The activity of a pure liquid is about 1. The activity of a solution is about its molar concentration. And the activity of a gas is about its partial pressure. We aren't correcting for this. We should be correcting for this, but we aren't. And that's because this is beyond the scope of this class. In the next higher level class, of course, you're going to be correcting for this. But in this class, we aren't. In this class, we're going to do this. We're going to assume that hopefully all the concentrations are low. If all the concentrations are low, then our error in our calculation will be relatively small. If we start going to higher and higher concentrations, then we've got to start worrying. This is like, for example, what is the pH scale run from? A lot of people say the pH scale runs from 0 to 14. But can you have a pH less than 0, like a negative pH? Is a negative pH possible? Or can you have a pH greater than 14? Is that possible? Yes, it is. The pH is less than 0, negative, and their pH is greater than 14. But the problem is this. When we're at a pH of zero, we're at 0.100 molar H plus. If we go below zero, then we're going to concentrations greater than 0.100 molar, which means that are those pH calculations going to work so ideally? No, we probably shouldn't be using the pH calculations as written in the book. We probably should be using activities rather than ideal concentrations in those. And then if the pHs go above 14, that's above 0.100 molar hydroxide. And so if we're, let's say, at 6 molar hydroxide, then we're already in the non-ideal range. And so this is why in Chem 4, they'll never give you a pH less than 0 and never give you a pH greater than 14 because the calculations going to be pretty inaccurate. Right. So can you read this? This is page 674. And look at this chart here from chapter 14. So going back to my potassium here, you know, even though this is pretty highly charged at minus 3, you know, this I expect to be fairly ideal because this is a big ion, and so the negative 3 is spread out over a large volume, and so it's very dilute, you know, it's not concentrated. And therefore, as the potassium ions go by this big, bulky ion here, are they going to be attracted very strongly? No, not so strongly. So this is going to behave fairly ideal. The potassium ions are moving, this is moving. Now, iron 3 is going to seek this out and then bond, probably ionically bond to it. And then another one, and then another one, and then we're going to get precipitate probably come out. But not in this case. And so potassium ions, I don't think, would be a very effective precipitating agent for this. But we're going to use potassium ions to precipitate it. Now, how are we going to use potassium ions to precipitate it? You know, one way to get the potassium ions to precipitate with this is like this. You know, let's say you have a fish tank. If you have a fish tank, the fish don't like to be right next to each other, do they? They like to kind of spread out in the fish tank. But what if you start evaporating all the water off? And so eventually the water evaporates off, and then pretty soon there's very little water left, and then the fish are going to be forced together. Okay? And so this is what we're going to do. What we're going to do is we're just going to boil off all the water. If we boil off all the water, then the potassium ions will be forced to crystallize with the, does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. They'll be forced to crystallize, and then I can precipitate it out. But the problem is this. That would be no problem. That would be great if it was only potassium and this. But what other junk is in here? What other stuff is in here is we dumped in a whole bunch of extra, what? Well, oxalic acid, but I think the oxalic acid is going to be pretty much consumed. We dumped in a whole bunch of potassium. Potassium dichromate should be gone. What was the excess reagent? Oxalic acid and potassium oxalate. So we dumped in a whole bunch of potassium oxalate, and so the problem is I'm going to get two precipitates. At least I'm going to precipitate out this, and I'm going to precipitate out potassium oxalate. And so if I get co-precipitation, that's called co-precipitation when I get two precipitates forming, is it easy to separate the two precipitates? No, because they're both potassium salt. And so they're both soluble in the water. So they're going to be both very difficult to separate. And so what I want to do is I want to precipitate out this, but leave the potassium oxalate in solution. I don't want the potassium oxalate to be precipitating out. I just want that to be precipitating out. Now, how am I going to manage that? Well, it turns out that I'm going to take advantage of difference in solubility. It turns out that potassium oxalate is much more soluble in alcohol, ethanol, than this. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to change the solvent. Rather than using water as my solvent, I'm going to change it to ethanol. If I use ethanol as my solvent, then the potassium oxalate, for the most part, will stay in the ethanol solution, whereas this will precipitate out of the ethanol because this isn't as soluble. And so how should I change the solvent? Well, one thing I could do is I could evaporate all the water until it's all evaporated, then dump in ethanol, right? But I'm not, because it turns out that ethanol and water are miscible. This is also a chapter 14 term, miscible. Do you know what miscible means? Immiscible means they don't mix. Miscible means they mix. They mix in all proportions. They're infinitely soluble in one another. And so what we're going to do is we're going to do something called solvent exchange. And so this is the final. Well, it's not really the final. There's still some more stuff, but kind of the final step in the synthesis, but not the final step in the lab. And that is, I'm going to force these three potassiums and this trioxalato. To precipitate. And I'm going to force it by doing this. You know, the solvent in chapter 14 is defined as the major species and the solute is the minor species in a homogeneous mixture. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to keep dumping in a whole bunch of ethanol. Ethanol is very miscible, so it starts off mostly water and a little bit of ethanol. Then I keep adding more and more ethanol, and pretty soon it becomes more ethanol and a little bit of water. Okay, at that point, it turns in from an aqueous solution to an ethanol solution. And so what I'll do is I'll just dump in a whole bunch of ethanol in here. But I don't want to just dump it in there. I want to slowly add it. Why do I want to slowly add it, the ethanol? Well, yeah, but there's another reason. Well, to reduce max products? Well, to get max products, you want lots of ethanol in there. And so what we can do is we can add it quickly or we can add it slowly. And both are going to give you the same kind of yield of products, the same number of grams. But the shorter amount of time would be to dump it in all at once. You dump it in all at once and throw it in an ice bath. Then you'll get the product quickly. It's not safer. Right. We don't want a microcrystalline product. You know, we want, we want big crystals. And so we want to add it slowly to try to nucleate. Remember nucleation? Did I talk about nucleation? Briefly? We don't want to nucleate a whole bunch of baby crystals. We want to nucleate a few baby crystals and let those baby crystals grow to big crystals. If you dump it in rapidly all at once, you'll nucleate a lot of little crystals, and those little crystals won't grow very big. And so we'll just slowly add this, and we're not going to cool it in an ice bath. We're just going to leave it at room temperature. And once you add enough ethanol, then what you're going to start seeing is you're going to start seeing this precipitating out. There's some water in there too, and this is going to be trapped in the solid. So what kind of reaction is this? This is an ion combination reaction, which is called a metathesis. So here we have all three. This is why I like this synthesis, because we have redox, acid base, and metathesis. And so we're going to do all three. Okay, so once we get these, then we're going to seal it up in our beaker and then leave it in our drawer. And hopefully we come back on Thursday, we'll see some nice crystals. If not, then we're going to try some other tricks that people do to get nice big crystals, which we'll probably end up doing it anyway. It's a process called recrystallization. Recrystallization is for further purifying and for growing nicer crystals. All right, any questions on this? All right, today's lab is lab days isn't so long. So near the end of lab, I'm going to talk about the report. You know, this lab, we're going to have to write a formal report for, where you're going to, you know, in the there's a section called the discussion section. In the discussion section, you can talk about the chemistry, you know, all this nucleation stuff and crystals and redox and Lewis acid base and metathesis, that kind of thing. But that section is probably the most challenging to write. We're going to start off with an easier section. The easier section is called the experimental section. The experimental section is what you did in the lab, you know, how you made this stuff, you know, what you mixed together, how long did it take, what colors did you see, this kind of stuff. So I'll give you some examples of experimental section. Maybe right now. Did you guys see the style guide I posted on Piazza? Style guide
for the report.
It's on Piazza. In the style guide, you're going to see this. You know, a report begins with a title. And the title, there's nowadays the titles, there's certain keywords that you're supposed to include in the title. But here's the title here: synthesis, structural characterization, and ab initio. Study of copper indium antimony alloys, it looks like. A new B8 related structure type. Then below the title is the byline. The byline will be all the authors. Usually the first author is the one you want to correspond with if you have any questions. And then their affiliations. What school or what company they're with. After that comes something called the abstract. The abstract is a one paragraph summary of the entire paper. And the abstract should have all the key results in here. And so most people, like 99% of the people, will only read the abstract. The only reason they'll read the rest of the paper is if they want the fine details. But you should be able to read the abstract and get all the key information out of there. Okay, the small percentage that actually are interested in this to read further, we'll go on to the introduction next. The introduction talks about, you know, maybe the history of these alloys, or maybe the technological importance of this system, or maybe the structure. This is about structure, so we'll talk about this unique structure. What are you going to talk about this? I mean, what the heck is this for? And so what you probably want to do is you probably want to do Google search, you know? Is this a natural product, or is this man-made? Or actually, human-made. I shouldn't say man-made. Could be man-made. But is that something that was synthesized? If it was synthesized, who synthesized it? When? And so it could be historical. Or maybe this has important applications. You know? For example, the last time I checked, do you know how much this stuff sells for? Last time I checked, it was about $250 for 5 grams of this. Too bad you can't sell your crystals, because probably nobody's going to want to buy them. and they probably won't trust them. They aren't characterized enough. You know what characterization is? You can make it, but how do you know the stuff you made is the stuff you think you made? That's what characterization is. So you characterize it by measuring its physical characteristics or its chemical characteristics, and make sure it matches with what's expected. But I mean, who would use this kind of stuff, and what is it used for? That kind of thing. And so you can put that kind of stuff here. Or you could talk about the chemistry. You know, this is kind of an interesting synthesis because we had redox, acid base, and metathesis. You could talk about that. You could talk about crystal growing. You know, just some background information in the introduction section.
Well, usually people will just do a Google search or something.
After the introduction section, we come to the experimental section. This is probably something you aren't going to be able to do. In the experimental section, they usually talk about the starting materials, where they got the starting materials, and how pure they are. So for example, they use copper from ABCR in the form of shots, and with a purity of 99.99%, four nines. The indium had six nines of purity from chem-pure ingots. And the antimony in shots at 5-9 purity. The more nines, the more expensive. Usually when you buy chemicals, you get a chemical analysis sheet which tells you what the major impurities are. And you look that over and make sure those major impurities aren't going to screw up your experiment. But basically they mix this. Okay, so they took the copper, the indium, and the antimony, and they were reacted in a molar ratio of 6:3:2. In an argon purge, the evacuated silica ampule at 900 degrees C. And so in something like this, they aren't telling you what to do. They aren't saying, take this, this, and this, and mix it together. They're telling you, well, we took this, this, and this, and mixed it together, and heated it to 900 degrees C. For how long? They should tell us for how long. Oh, they did, 3 days. After furnace cooling, the sample was placed in an aluminum block and annealed at 300 degrees C in a muffle furnace for 30 days. So they just told us how they made it and how they processed it. The second part of this experimental section, they're talking about how they characterized it using x-rays and stuff like that. But we aren't going to be using x-rays to characterize this stuff. Here's another experimental section here. Synthesis and characterization of DHTA6, they're saying a well-mixed solid of this, and they give us the amounts, 800 milligrams or 3.72 millimoles, or one equivalent, and 2-3 this, with a mass of 626 milligrams. So these are the actual masses they use. These aren't the masses that they say. So for example, in ours, it says, add 3.6 grams slowly. Well, maybe you didn't put 3.6 grams. You know, it's excess, so it's not worth trying to get it right on 3.6. And so you're going, wait, let me get it right on 3.60. Are you gonna waste the time? No. I mean, if it came out to 3.8, 5, no big deal, you know? Because that's the excess reagent. Or is that? No, you gotta be careful. You don't want to overshoot the limiting reagent too much. If you overshoot the limiting reagent, you could screw up the experiment. Excess reagent we can overshoot. Not expensive. But anyway, so they're telling us the actual amounts and what they actually did. So all of this is past tense. When you read a procedure, it's not. A procedure is present tense usually. Was heated to 400 degrees C rather than heat this mixture to 400 degrees C for 10 minutes. If you say heat this mixture at 400 degrees C for 10 minutes, it's not clear whether you did that. Here it's clear. It was heated to 400 degrees C for 10 minutes. Then ETOH, what's ETOH? Ethanol. This is an abbreviation for ethanol. Then ETOH, or ethanol, was added to the hot mixture. This dark colored suspension in ethanol, they added 50 milliliters of ethanol, was sonicated at 60 degrees C, 1 hour, filtered, hydrated and washed, etc. So they go on through characterization. So today, you know, you're going to be writing your observations. What you want to do is you want to let your neighbor or your partner read your observations from last week, and then also read the observations from this week, because what you want is you want somebody else to read it, and they should have a clear picture in their mind of what you did, so much so that they could repeat the experiment exactly the way you did it with the same amounts you used to get the same results. All right, so what you want to do is, after you take your observations today, maybe you want to whip up a quick paragraph. Okay, this is what I'm going to use in the formal report as a procedure, as a rough draft. Okay? We'll have plenty of time to do that. All right, any questions? All right, I'm going to stop talking, and then we're going to work with a partner today, you know, or a partner. Try to keep the group size small, on the smaller side, if possible, or you could work solo if you want. If need be, we might have to go with a group of three. We have an odd number. Okay. All right, that's it. You're not going to check out anything from the stock.